Welcome back to embryology session on development of alimentary system. Here comes part 4, development of hindgut. Following are the objectives for this part. We are going to see the divisions of hindgut, listing out all the derivatives of hindgut, focusing on development of rectum and anal canal, histogenesis of hindgut tube and congenital anomalies. So let's begin with the divisions of hindgut. Here is the primitive hindgut seen in tail fold of embryo. Caudal most portion of hindgut known as tail gut, which in later stages regresses. Primitive hindgut extends between posterior intestinal portal cranially, cloacal membrane caudally, which is a bilaminar membrane formed by surface ectoderm and endoderm without intervening mesoderm. The ventral wall of primitive hindgut shows an endodermal outgrowth known as allantoic diverticulum or allantois. During fourth week of development, primitive hindgut is suspended by dorsal mesentery, through which artery of hindgut, that is inferior mesenteric artery, passes to supply the hindgut. Here is the allantoic diverticulum, which is an endodermal outgrowth from ventral wall of primitive hindgut. It grows into developing umbilical cord. Depending on the position of allantoic diverticulum, primitive hindgut can be divided into two parts: cranial part known as pre-allantoic part and caudal part known as post-allantoic part. Further, pre-allantoic part grows as a narrow tube, whereas post-allantoic part starts dilating. Such dilated portion of hindgut called as endodermal cloaca, which is related ventrally with cloacal membrane. Cloacal membrane at this stage shows few changes. Let's observe those changes on this image. It is the ventral view of cloacal membrane. Initially, it shows a central depression longitudinally, known as cloacal groove, which has a raised margins called as genital folds. During this stage, the mesodermal cells from primitive streak starts migrating more ventrally on either side of genital folds and form genital swellings. Such migrating mesodermal cells reach cranial portion of cloacal groove, where they proliferate and aggregate to form a cellular mass called as genital tubercle. Here it is, which is a mesodermal cells aggregation seen at the cranial part of cloacal membrane. By the end of fifth week, let's observe the further changes in cloacal membrane. Here is the cloacal membrane with its genital groove. Here is the genital tubercle at its cranial end. Mesodermal cells of genital tubercle start proliferating and migrating more ventrally and cranially towards umbilical cord, so that they are involved in the formation of infraumbilical part of anterior abdominal wall. As the cells proliferate more rapidly, anterior abdominal wall increases in length, whereas tail end of the fetus regresses, so that the genital groove becomes more deepened and moves from ventral to caudal position of cloaca. Such deepened genital groove lined by ectoderm called as ectodermal cloaca. Now, the ectodermal cloaca and endodermal cloaca are separated by bilaminar cloacal membrane at the caudal end of primitive hindgut. Before looking into the further changes in cloaca, let's know what are all the derivatives of hindgut. Let's start with the derivatives of preallantoic part of primitive hindgut. Here is the midgut loop undergoing rotation. While doing so, it pushes the dorsal mesentery of hindgut towards left side so that the preallantoic part of hindgut occupies left part of abdominal cavity. Eventually, derivatives from preallantoic part are seen in the left part of abdominal cavity. They are transverse colon left 1/3 portion, whereas the right 2/3 is given off from midgut. So the most proximal portion of preallantoic part give rise to left 1/3 of transverse colon. Transverse colon continues as descending colon at a sharp bend known as left colic flexure or splenic flexure of the colon. Descending colon continues below as sigmoid colon. So the transverse colon left 1/3 portion, descending colon and sigmoid colon are the definitive derivatives of preallantoic part of primitive hindgut. Now let's see what happens to dorsal mesentery, which is suspending the preallantoic part of hindgut. Here is the transverse colon and here is the dorsal mesentery of midgut and preallantoic part of hindgut, which remains as transverse mesocolon, suspending the transverse colon. A portion of dorsal mesentery of preallantoic part at left colic flexure remains as phrenicocolic ligament, which extends between left colic flexure and diaphragm. It is the remnant of inferior retention band, which is developmentally a thickening of mesodermal cells in dorsal mesentery of preallantoic part of hindgut. Dorsal mesentery suspending the descending colon fuses with peritoneal layer of dorsal wall and disappears, so that descending colon becomes retroperitoneal in position, whereas dorsal mesentery suspending the sigmoid colon remains as sigmoid mesocolon. So the remnants of dorsal mesentery of preallantoic part of hindgut are transverse mesocolon, its left 1/3 portion, and sigmoid mesocolon, making descending colon retroperitoneal in position. Coming to postallantoic part derivatives or endodermal cloaca derivatives, they are rectum, upper part of anal canal, and mucus lining of urinary bladder and urethra. Dorsal mesentery suspending the endodermal cloaca later on regresses, so that all the derivatives of postallantoic part become retroperitoneal or non-peritoneal. Now it's time to focus on development of rectum and anal canal, which are the derivatives of postallantoic part of hindgut. Let's see the changes occurring in endodermal cloaca during 5th to 7th week. Here is the cloaca with allantoic diverticulum and preallantoic part of hindgut. Initially, the splanchnopleuric layer mesodermal cells seen at the junction of allantois and hindgut start proliferating and migrating caudally, so that they push the endoderm at the junction of allantois and hindgut more caudally, so that an endodermal fold is formed called as urorectal fold. Such urorectal fold grows more caudally into the cloaca to form an endodermal urorectal septum. Formation of urorectal septum in cloaca plays a major role in deriving the structures from it. Urorectal septum, it's a coronally oriented partition within the cloaca, which means it divides the cloaca into ventral and dorsal parts in future. It grows more caudally towards cloacal membrane to fuse with it. Structurally, urorectal septum has three elements. Let's observe this image to know the elements of urorectal septum. Here is the interior of cloaca with allantois and pre-allantoic part of hindgut. Here is the urorectal fold growing caudally into the cloaca to form urorectal septum, which has three elements. They are vertical element and two lateral elements. Vertical element is here, which is formed by caudal growth of urorectal fold. Lateral elements seen on the lateral wall of the cloaca, formed by course of paramesonephric and mesonephric ducts, which are running outside the cloaca bilaterally. Vertical element is also known as tonic's fold, seen at the junction of allantois and pre-allantoic part of hindgut. Lateral elements are known as Rathke's folds, seen on the lateral walls of cloaca. Each Rathke's fold consists of a paramesonephric duct, more laterally mesonephric duct. So the urorectal septum formed grows more caudally towards cloacal membrane, to which it fuses and divides the cloaca into two parts. That is the purpose of formation of urorectal septum, dividing the cloaca into ventral part and dorsal part. Ventral part is known as primitive urogenital sinus. Dorsal part is known as primitive rectum. So during 5th to 7th week, what we see is the formation of urorectal septum in endodermal cloaca. It is formed by three elements. One vertical element called as tonic's fold and two lateral elements called as Rathke's folds, which fuse with each other in coronal plane to divide the endodermal cloaca into ventral primitive urogenital sinus and dorsal primitive rectum. Here is the endodermal cloaca. We'll take a cross section through it to see the formation of urorectal septum. Here is the vertical element. Here are the two lateral elements fusing in coronal plane to form urogenital sinus and primitive rectum. A point to be understood here is, before the endodermal cloaca completely divides into two parts, its ventral part is continuous with its dorsal part through a narrow canal during 7th week of development. Such connecting narrow canal is called as cloacal duct, which is nothing but a gap between caudal free margin of urorectal septum and cloacal membrane, which is closed by the fusion of urorectal septum and the cloacal membrane by the end of 7th week. Now let's see the changes occurring at ectodermal cloaca during 7th to 10th week. Here is the cloacal membrane and here is the ectodermal cloaca. Once the urorectal septum meets the cloacal membrane, the cloacal membrane can be divided into two parts. Ventral part called as urogenital membrane and dorsal part called as anal membrane. urogenital membrane related caudally with primitive urogenital sinus, whereas anal membrane related caudally with primitive rectum. The junction where the urorectal septum meets the cloacal membrane forms perineal body, which is one of the structural supports for pelvic viscera. Let's see the fate of anal membrane. Here is the anal membrane and here is the primitive rectum. Mesodermal cells surrounding the anal membrane undergo proliferation and start migrating more caudally, so that anal membrane shows a surface depression called as ectodermal proctodium or anal pit. Meanwhile, mesodermal cells of perineal body proliferate and grow more backwards, separating primitive urogenital sinus and primitive rectum. At later stages, central cells of anal membrane undergo degeneration and the membrane ruptures so that anal canal is formed, through which hindgut communicates with amniotic cavity. Position of anal membrane represents position of pectinate line or anal valves in an adult. Now let's see a few features of definitive rectum and anal canal. Here is the coronal section through rectum and anal canal. Interior of rectum lined by mucous membrane, which is thrown into folds called as rectal valves, which are 4 in number, position of which may vary except for third valve of rectum. Here is the anal canal. Its interior shows 3 different regions separated by above pectinate line and below Hilton's white line. Pectinate line is formed by anal valves, which represent anal membrane developmentally. Now let's summarize the development of rectum. Here is the interior of rectum with its third valve, which represents the attachment of allantoic diverticulum to primitive hindgut. Depending on its position, interior of rectum can be divided into 2 parts developmentally: part above the third valve and part below the third valve. Upper part derived from pre-allantoic part of hindgut, whereas lower part is derived from dorsal part of endodermal cloaca. Moving on to development of anal canal. Here is the interior of anal canal, showing pectinate line, which represents attachment of anal membrane developmentally, so that interior of anal canal can be divided into 2 parts developmentally: part above the pectinate line and part below the pectinate line. Upper part derived from dorsal part of endodermal cloaca, whereas lower part is derived from ectodermal proctodium. Let's see the histogenesis of hindgut. Histologically, only the mucous lining of hindgut is derived from endoderm, whereas the other layers, submucous, muscular and serous coats, are derived from splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. Meconium discharged from large gut can be swallowed by fetus occasionally, as it starts functioning before birth itself. Now it's time to see the congenital anomalies of hindgut. Hirschsprung's disease. It's a condition in which a portion of large intestine, usually proximal to anal canal, shows persistent narrowing due to congenital agenesis of nerve cells which form myenteric and submucous plexuses in the wall of the gut, due to which that portion of the gut becomes devoid of parasympathetic innervation and fails to respond to peristaltic movements. Eventually, hyperresponsive sympathetic nerves induce a persistent spasm, so that portion of large intestine proximal to that constriction becomes distended, which is why it is also known as congenital megacolon. Such anomaly can be treated surgically by resection of constricted portion and subsequent mobilization of proximal dilated gut to the anal region. Undivided cloaca. It's a rare condition where urorectal septum fails to develop completely, so that the cloaca becomes undivided. It opens to exterior after rupture of cloacal membrane through a common perineal orifice, so that the definitive passages of genitourinary system and alimentary system will have a common perineal outlet. Such phenomena is normally seen in birds. Imperforate anus. It may be due to the following reasons: failure of rupture of anal membrane, or failure of formation of ectodermal proctodium, or atresia of lower part of the rectum, due to which rectum may end as a blind sac, or it may open into adjacent passages by forming fistula. Such fistulas are known as rectal fistulae. Ectopic anus. It is due to failure of backward growth of perineal body cells, which separate urogenital membrane and anal membrane developmentally, so that in definitive position, anal orifice and urogenital orifice lie very closely. In males, the anal opening may be seen at the base of scrotum. In females, it may be seen within the vestibule, close to vaginal orifice. Rectal fistula. It's an abnormal communication between rectum and adjacent passages. It is formed due to failure of approximation of three elements of urorectal septum, so that cloacal duct remains patent, connecting primitive urogenital sinus ventrally and primitive rectum dorsally. Depending on which element of urorectal septum fails to grow, rectal fistulae can be classified into two types: high fistulae and low fistulae. In high fistula, vertical element of urorectal septum fails to grow caudally to fuse with lateral elements, so that rectovesical fistula is formed, where the rectum opens into urinary bladder at its internal trigone level. In low fistula, lateral elements of urorectal septum fails to fuse with each other to form rectourethral fistula in males and rectovaginal fistula in females. In both the conditions, anal pit remains rudimentary with imperforate anus. Here is the end of part 4, development of hindgut, completing the development of alimentary system. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.